Hello, this is Akram Jafar, and in this video I am going to deal with some picture tests and practical anatomy of the lower limb. This video deals with the knee and the popliteal fossa. You may use the video as a revision or as a self-assessment tool. For the purpose of self-assessment, pause the video and spend some time to read the question and come up with the answer. Then replay the video to confirm your answer by listening to the comments and explanations. Identify the ligament. The ligament A is attached to the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus. Look at the fibula here. This is the lateral side, and this is the posterior aspect of the knee joint. You can see the femoral condyles here. And so this is the lateral meniscus, and this ligament connects between the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus and the medial condyle of the femur. It's called meniscofemoral ligament. This is usually a ligament with two bands, and they clasp the posterior cruciate ligament, or sometimes it's considered as two ligaments. You can see that this is not the posterior cruciate ligament. The posterior cruciate ligament is here. It is attached to the posterior intercondylar area of the tibia, and then goes up and medially toward the medial condyle of the femur. This one, the meniscofemoral ligament, is attached to the meniscus itself, not to the tibia, and it helps in moving the lateral meniscus. You can see that the lateral meniscus is not attached to the lateral collateral ligament like the medial meniscus, and it increases the congruity of the meniscus with the changing surface of the femoral condyle, as well as it protects the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus by pulling it out of the harm's way during movements of the knee joint. Which tendon occupies this space? This is a space that is, it is intracapsular, of course, because this is the lateral collateral ligament, thickening in the capsule of the joint, of the knee joint, that extends between the lateral femoral condyle and the fibula. And you can see here that there is a tendon of a muscle that passes within the capsule of the knee joint. The muscle is attached here. This is the soleal line, and this is the popliteal surface of the tibia. And so the fleshy muscle fibers are located here, and then the tendon passes within the joint to be attached to the lateral condyle of the femur, and there are some slips attached to the lateral meniscus as well to push it out of the harm's way. So this space is occupied by the tendon of popliteus muscle. The popliteus muscle is the muscle that unlocks the locked knee. During locking of the knee joint, there is medial rotation of the femur on the tibia. So this muscle will cause lateral rotation of the femur on the tibia as it pulls in this direction. And this will result in unlocking of the knee joint prior to flexion of the knee. Identify the joint C. C is the proximal or the superior tibiofibular joint. It is a plane type of synovial joint and allows only a minor degree of gliding that takes place during dorsiflexion and ankle flexion. Note that this joint does not communicate with the cavity of the knee joint, unlike the superior or the proximal radioulnar joint, which communicates with the cavity of the elbow joint, the counterpart of the knee joint in the upper limb. Identify the structure D. What is its function? So D is the interosseous membrane that connects between the tibia and fibula and constitutes another fibrous joint between the tibia and fibula. The function of this ligament is that it connects the tibia and fibula, as well as it provides for muscle attachment. It separates compartments of the leg, anterior and posterior compartment, and provides for the attachment of some of the muscles of the anterior compartment and the deep muscles of the posterior compartment. Which bone articulates with the flat surface A? This is the flat surface for the head of the fibula, forming the proximal or the superior tibiofibular joint. You can see it is separated from the surface of the knee joint, and these two joints are separate from each other. Which muscle is attached to the dotted line? The line here, this is the soleal line, and it's called soleal line because it is here that the soleus muscle is attached, and then the attachment of the soleus muscle is taken by an arch to reach the fibula. So the remaining part of the muscle is attached to the fibula, and the arch here provides for the passage of a neurovascular bundle, tibial nerve and the posterior tibial artery. The surface here above the soleal line of the tibia is the popliteal surface. And it is here that the popliteus muscle is attached, and its fibers converge to form a tendon that is attached to the lateral condyle of the femur. Identify the muscle A, list three of its functions. Now this is the popliteal fossa. You can see this is superior here, then here's the medial side. So this is the lateral side. And we can also figure out the lateral side without having these directional signs. You can see here the long tendon of semitendinosus muscle, and this is the semimembranosus deep to it. So this is on the medial side. And here, this is the tendon of biceps femoris muscle. Also, you can see that the sciatic nerve splits at the apex of the popliteal fossa, and it gives a branch to the lateral side, which passes along the lateral border of the fossa. This is the common peroneal or common fibular nerve, which passes along the tendon of biceps femoris muscle until it reaches the neck of the fibula here. So this is the lateral side, and the muscle is the biceps femoris muscle. The biceps femoris has a long head that arises from the ischial tuberosity. It's a hamstring muscle, so it arises from the common origin of the hamstring muscles, which is the ischial tuberosity. Therefore, it acts on the hip joint, so it extends the hip. And as you can see here, that it passes behind the knee joint and is going to be joined by the short head of biceps femoris, which arises from the femur and does not act on the hip joint, but it acts on the knee together with the long head, as they are fused together to be attached to the fibula. So they flex the knee. That's the second action. And the third action is that because they are attached to the lateral side of the knee joint, distal to the knee, they can laterally rotate the leg when the knee is flexed, only when the knee is flexed. Otherwise, when the knee is extended, it cannot be rotated medially or laterally. It is a hinge joint. Identify the nerve B. The nerve B is located superficial to the gastrocnemius muscle. In fact, this is a cutaneous nerve, and if we follow it up, we will find that it is formed by the union of two branches. One comes from the common peroneal nerve, and the other one comes from the tibial nerve. This is the tibial nerve that passes straight forward, the most superficial structure of the neurovascular bundle in the popliteal fossa. It's called the tibial nerve. So it contributes a branch, and then another branch comes from the common peroneal nerve to form this cutaneous branch, which is the sural or shural nerve. The shural nerve continues down to supply the skin on the distal half of the back of the leg, and then it passes behind the lateral malleolus at the ankle to continue to supply the lateral aspect of the foot. So it is related to the posterior aspect of the lateral malleolus. Remember that there is another cutaneous nerve on the medial side related to the anterior aspect of the medial malleolus, not the posterior aspect, anterior aspect, and this is the saphenous nerve, a branch of the femoral nerve. Identify the arteries, locate the best place where each one of them can be palpated. This is an angiogram showing here, you can see the shadow of the tibia. This is the anterior part, the tuberosity of the tibia, the plateaus, and these are the condyles of the femur. And so the artery is located posterior to the tibia and posterior to the femur. This is the popliteal artery, the direct continuation of the femoral artery. You can see that it supplies some genicular branches and muscular branches as well. Then at the distal border of the popliteus muscle, it divides into an anterior tibial artery, which passes in between the tibia and fibula, in between the two bones, above the interosseous membrane, and supplies the anterior compartment of the leg. Anterior tibial artery. It passes in front of the two malleoli, between them, and can be palpated there, but better, we can palpate its continuity, which is the dorsalis pedis artery on the dorsum of the foot, just lateral to the tendon of extensor hallucis longus. The third artery here is the posterior tibial artery, which is the continuity of the popliteal artery, passes deep to the arch and the origin of soleus muscle, And this artery can be palpated posterior to the medial malleolus at the ankle before it splits into medial and lateral plantar arteries that supply the sole of the foot. So the posterior tibial artery can be palpated behind the medial malleolus. Which of the following muscles causes slight lateral rotation of the femur on the tibia as it flexes the knee joint? Let's identify the area. This is a deep dissection of the popliteal fossa. You can see here, this is the superior aspect, and this side is the lateral side. You can see the tendon of biceps femoris here. Also, you can see the common peroneal nerve going parallel with the tendon of biceps until it reaches the neck of the fibula. Here, you can see the two heads of gastrocnemius. To make sure that this is the lateral head of gastrocnemius B, note that here, this is the plantaris muscle, which arises in common with the lateral head of gastrocnemius. So this is the medial head of gastrocnemius. The muscle here is part of the soleus muscle. The remaining part of soleus has been removed. Now, if we go to the inset, which is magnified here, you can see the soleus again here. And this muscle, of course, the soleus is attached to the soleal line of the tibia. And above the soleal line of the tibia, the area is called the popliteal surface of the tibia. It provides attachment for the muscle, which is the popliteus, and you can see that the popliteus forms a tendon that goes laterally and enters deep to the capsule of the knee joint to be attached to the lateral side of the condyle of the femur. And so when the muscle contracts, it will first of all laterally rotate the femur on the tibia, and this unlocks the locked knee. What is meant by the locked knee is that there is medial rotation of the femur on the tibia to tighten the ligament so that the knee becomes stable in extension. So before we start the flexion, we need unlocking, which is the opposite of the locking. Since the locking is medial rotation of the femur on the tibia, then unlocking is lateral rotation of the femur on the tibia. And then after that, this muscle also participates in flexion because it crosses behind the knee joint. But of course, it is not that important flexor, but it is important lateral rotator of the femur, because there are other important flexors of the knee, like the gastrocnemius, for example, the hamstring compartment, and so on. Which of the numbered ligaments is most important in keeping the femur from slipping backward on the tibia? First of all, let's identify the ligaments. In this dissection of the knee, although we are not given any signs of orientation, but we can look at the distal end of the femur. Look at this condyle here. This is the lateral condyle. It's more prominent anteriorly than the medial condyle. So this is the lateral side. It's more prominent in order to prevent lateral dislocation of the patella as a bony factor. Also, you can make sure that the tibial articular surface on the medial side is more or less oval and not rounded like the one that is located on the lateral side. Also, you can see here, this is the subcutaneous surface of the tibia. There are no muscles here, and the upper part of the subcutaneous surface provides for the attachment of these three muscles, long, slender muscles, sartorius, gracilis, and semitendinosus muscle. So this is the medial side, and so this ligament here extends from the anterior intercondylar area of the tibia to the lateral condyle of the femur, the inside of the lateral condyle of the femur, and is located anteriorly. It is the anterior cruciate ligament, while as you can see here, this is the posterior aspect of the knee showing the posterior cruciate ligament. The other ligaments 2 and 4, these are the collateral ligaments. So this is the lateral collateral ligament, and here it is easy to understand that this is the lateral. You can see the fibula, this is on the lateral side, but in addition to that, even if you don't see the fibula, you can see that the lateral collateral ligament is cord-like, rounded, and also it is separated from the lateral meniscus. There is a space here that allows the passage of the tendon of popliteus. While on the medial side, the medial or tibial collateral ligament is more or less, it is flattened and it is longer than the lateral collateral ligament. And as you can see that it is firmly attached to the medial meniscus of the knee joint. Now, which of the numbered ligament is most important in keeping the femur from slipping backward on the tibia? This is the anterior cruciate ligament. The anterior cruciate ligament extends from anterior to posterior, and so it will pull the femur forwards and prevents it slipping backwards. If this ligament is cut, then In a flexed knee, the tibia can be pulled further forwards on the femur. This is called the anterior drawer sign. The opposite is in case of rupture of the posterior cruciate ligament here. The posterior cruciate ligament prevents forward gliding of the femur on the tibia. And if it is cut, then the tibia can be pushed. When the knee is flexed, the tibia is pushed further backwards on the femur. This is called the posterior drawer sign. During a routine physical examination, the physician taps the ligament indicated by the asterisk with a reflex hammer and elicits a knee-jerk reflex. Which of the following nerves mediates the reflex? This is the patellar tendon, or ligamentum patelli. You can see the patella here. This fibrous tissue here is called the quadriceps tendon, and it's attached to the patella, which is a sesamoid bone, and from the patella starts the patellar tendon, which is attached to the tuberosity of the tibia. Tapping the tendon here will cause contraction of the quadriceps femoris muscle, which is supplied by the femoral nerve. So, in fact, the femoral nerve is tested, or the spinal root segments that serve the femoral nerve, and these are L2, 3, and 4. Which of the following structures is a muscle tendon? This is a dissection of the knee joint. The femur has been removed. Here's the anterior aspect, and you can see the patella and the patellar ligament have been reflected anteriorly. This is the posterior aspect here, and you can see here this is the medial side. Look at the medial collateral ligament, number 5, which is flat and is closely related to the meniscus. This is the medial meniscus. I can easily tell that this is the medial meniscus because it is longer anteroposteriorly than the lateral meniscus. And this is a reflection of the shape of the articular surface of the distal end of the femur. On the lateral side, it is rounded, the articular surface for the tibia, and on the medial side, it is more or less oval. So this is a crescentic, and this is C-shaped. You can see that the anterior and posterior horns of the lateral meniscus are located within the anterior and posterior horns of the medial meniscus. So 3 is the lateral meniscus, and this side is on the lateral side, and you can see here that this is the lateral collateral ligament, lateral fibular ligament. Look at it. The section is rounded. If you compare it with the more flattened section on this side of the tibial collateral ligament, and look at the fibular collateral ligament, it is not attached to the lateral meniscus. There is a tendon of muscle that passes obliquely here from behind the tibia, and this is the popliteus tendon within the joint. Has some fibers attached to the meniscus, and the other fibers ascend up to be attached to the lateral condyle of the femur. What remains is 4, and this is a transverse ligament that attaches the anterior horns of the lateral and medial menisci. It's not a tendon of a muscle. Just to finish identification of other structures, you can see here that this is the stump of the anterior cruciate ligament, and that will be the stump of the posterior cruciate ligament attached to the anterior and posterior intercondylar areas of the tibia respectively.